Hello, Yuri Resnik here from Brightcove, and today I'll talk about origins of some strange things in video. The idea of the talk will be to look back in history and try to understand what were the motivations and ideas behind some very seemingly strange numbers and design decisions that we might encounter today in video technologies. To start with, let me just take a look at frame rates and note that in modern day systems we have several families of such. Some are multiple of 24, some multiple 25, some 30, and then there are some really strange looking numbers like 2997, 23976, 5994. Who invented all of this and for what reason? Turns out each family of frame rates has its own distinct history and different motivations. For example, 24 frames per second were standardized in design of first film movie projectors. Thomas Edison in the 30s was working on this. And remind you that at that time film cameras were still hand cranked, so the input video film content was still variable frame rate and pretty jerky, but at projector side they decided to fix it, and that was probably the first standard in video industry adopted. So 24 frames per second, still with us. 25 and 30 frames per second came from completely different origins. They came about during designs of first receivers for black and white analog television systems, also around 30s and maybe early 40s. The engineers working on these receivers, what they realized is that it's quite advantageous to synchronize vertical refresh on those systems with frequency of AC utility power, 50 Hz in Europe, 60 Hz in US. And this is how we have 25 and 30 frames per second. It was a brilliant decision of its time. It made design simpler. It avoided few problems, vertical like drift and many other issues. But today we enjoy these frame rates. And 2997, another fractional one, came with work of NTSC Commission in 1953. Which tried to design first color television system, and the problem that they tried to solve was actually a pretty peculiar one. They tried to squeeze chroma information in bands that was already allocated for black and white television, and they decided not to change it. And so to squeeze chroma there, they had to make a few constraints. And one of them was to reduce frame rate. So dropping one frame out of 1001 was producing 2997, and we still enjoy it today. In fact, recently in Ultra HD television, Ultra HD forum adopted 1988 frame rate. So, design decisions of 1953 still with us and follow in Ultra HD era of television. Sequences of lines. This is another truly fascinating invention, and it actually was made in 1880. Just to put it in perspective, it's like 50 years before first black and white television systems, 20 years before Marconi on transmission of radio waves and his telegraph. It was also years before first cinetoscopes and moving pictures were shown to public. So the idea was to scan video line by line to enable transmissions. Of course, nowadays we well aware of scan orders such as progressive and interlace, but thanks Maurice LeBlanc for coming up with the idea. Telesyn. This is another reminder of glorious past. It was an absolutely brilliant idea of its time, and it solved very pressing practical problem. It was films that was, of course, shot on progressive forms, frame by frame, at 24 frames per second. And then first broadcast systems used interlaced, and in the US they used 30 frames per second or 2997. And there was a need to do conversion between those two formats. And the only means for conversion at the time that were available were very primitive devices like tape recorders. So what Sintel in 1950s did, they built this machine that was basically taking video, taking each frame, splitting it into two fields, and then doing cheating. You know, some fields were projected for honest duration of a frame, and some fields were projected twice. So that created few frames that had fields from different adjacent frames stitched, but if you play it at fast enough frame rate and with interlaced displays, it looked okay. Brilliant invention of its time, and unfortunately, it's still used broadly today. Pretty much all progressive content sent over broadcast workflows still gets telesynced, and of course, it's such a nonsense, technically speaking, by today's days. It increases data rate, it creates all sorts of problems with conversion block to progressive. There are indeed more efficient techniques, soft telesynths. Why we are using interlaces, another good question. So, but this thing is still with us. Probably will be with us for a while. Pixels, resolution, SARs, and DARs. Well, mercifully, now we're talking about digital systems where each frame is presented as a matrix of pixels, but what we must realize that pixels initially were not square. Of course, today's in graphics world, we think that pixels are square, right? But in design of first digital television systems were not. And in fact, NTSC and DVB, when they worked on this, they picked several sampling rate at which it could be turned into pixels, and none of them was producing a square of them. So that created a concept of SAR, sample aspect ratio, and a whole plurality of SD formats. The invent of Ultra HD TV turned display aspect ratio to different number. Before it was 4:3, then it was 16:9 introduced, and of course that created whole new chain of formats, and with widescreen content, DCI, digital cinema content, we have even more aspect ratios and different resolutions and formats that we all enjoy these days. But if we look at plurality of all those different numbers for used for height and width for different standard formats, I must say standard, we actually find one thing that is quite remarkable. It turns out that all these numbers are products of very small primes. In fact, if you look at all standard television formats, they are products of only three numbers, 2, 3, and 5. This might be shocking, and you might ask why. Well, turns out it's by design. You know, I remind you that television systems were designed to build hardware, and build hardware, you care about complexity of conversion operations. And of course, if you implement conversions between different formats, you want to make it simpler. And when you present all these numbers as composites of simple primes, what it means is that the ratios between different possible targets, if you do conversions, will also be simple, because some of these powers of primes will cancel out, and that will yield a small enough irreducible fraction m over n, and the m in that case will be defining number of phases in a polyphase filter decomposition that you will need to implement the resampler. So a brilliant concept, a very neat idea, and you know, if you generate videos, please try to make them simple. Chances are you will be sending it to a receiver that still needs to stay by one of these properties. Audio sampling rates. You know that audio sampling, hearing range in humans about 20 hertz, 20 kilohertz. So to sample, you need at least 40 kilohertz, according to Shannon and Nyquist. But in practice, of course, it's always desirable to oversample it a bit. Why? Because practical filters are not ideal. You always have transition bands. The wider the transition band, the simpler could be filter, or the flatter could be response. This is desirable. And which is why most practical audio systems use 48 kilohertz or multiple of it. It's used in NTSC, it's used in DVD, Blu-rays, and so on. But curiously enough, in design of CDs, Sony and Philips picked a different sampling rate. It was 44.1, another odd number. And why? So this might almost sound like an anecdote, but it's confirmed by several sources that when CD design was almost ready for release, they approached Sony and Philips approached a famous conductor Herbert von Karajan to endorse it, and he said yes, but under one condition: I want it to be able to hold the longest performance that I could conduct, which turned out to be Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. It was 74 minutes long, and so to squeeze that 74 minutes in this format, they had to compromise on sampling rate. This is why we have 44.1. Credit goes to von Karajan and Ludwig van Beethoven. And color spaces. This is another fascinating topic, and of course we have multiple color spaces standardized by CAE, and they're all based on translation of certain concepts from color science theory to practice. For example, XYZ color space of 1931 is fundamental, same as XY chromaticity diagram. The so-called perceptually uniform color spaces, CAE, LAB, CAL, UV, were honest attempts to design spaces that uniform in perceptual sense from color science perspective. But then there were also color spaces designed based on some other practical constraints and considerations. And color spaces developed for first television systems belong to same category. So the credit for creation of YUV color space belongs to Georges Valency, an engineer who was working at Thomson at this time, and in 1938 he invented first variant of YUV color space. And guess what was grand motivation for it? It was design of color space that enables backwards compatible transmission with black and white television. So the chroma had to be aligned precisely to the intensity used by black and white system. It had to be non-linear as a result of it, and everything else in the design of transform was kind of forced by this constraint. Brilliant accomplishment of its time. The reason TV systems built by RCA color spaces, color television, become successful and one designed in non-backwards compatible by CBS was not successful is precisely the compatibilities with all receivers. That's the reason we have YUV color spaces designed the way they are. And of course, from pure color science perspective, they make no sense. They are non-linear, they are not perceptually uniform, not even close, they have no physical meaning. Luma doesn't mean luminance, chroma doesn't mean chrominance. There are some other funny things. For example, the non-linearity is used at camera and display and don't match in some systems. For instance, HDTV, the display is used 2.4 gamma and the cameras use 2.2 or BT709. Why? I think I need another talk to talk about it. It's pretty complicated. But now let's talk about chroma subsampling, and this is the last slide. So this is really relates to certain phenomena of vision, and it was an honest attempt to exploit it by Aldo Bedford, who in 1940s and late 40s, 50s came up with several techniques for doing it. And the underlying phenomena is that we have three types of receptors, of course, and they form mosaic, and the blue or short cones, they have the sparsest appearance. They cover only 3%, and then green and blue and red ones or medium and long ones, they tend to produce clusters or speckles, and their separation, spatial separation between different color channels is not great. What it all boils down to is that our contrast sensitivity or acuity in black and white domain is much higher as opposed to acuity measured in color difference spaces. And Aldo Bedford came up with few techniques. One of them was YQ color space, which was a variant of YUV with rotated chroma channels and with sampling adapted to it encoded more efficiently. So brilliant and invention of its time. NTSC was a success story indeed, in part because of this. And we still enjoy it today in form of YCBCR and 420 Chroma. But we might ask question, does it still make sense today? And turns out that it really depends. If you use classical reproduction setting assumed for television system, like 1080p screen, and you're sitting three heights away from the screen, then it makes perfect sense. At this point, the resolution of a screen matches your acuity in black and white domain almost exactly. And if you downsample chroma, then encoded chroma response is still going to be wider than your acuity in color difference. So it's still a perfectly designed system. But if you move and sit closer, you sit, for example, at one height away from screen or one and a half height, this changes equation. Another example of change will be you take a smaller resolution video and you blit it full screen. This also changes calibration. You end up in a reproduction setting where what you encode as chroma doesn't have enough bandwidth and what you see is actually more. So at this point, your reproduction become compromised. So you better use 444 if that's what you're doing. In fact, in modern ABR systems with multi-screen and use of smaller resolutions where you really don't know how and where they will be stretched and projected to screen, it's definitely safer to use 444. Well, maybe in design of these systems, we also shouldn't use YUV color space, since we know that it's designed for backwards compatibility with black and white. But another topic, and of course there are many other things that could be discussed in the future, but hope this was informative, and thank you very much.